You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And you might guess by looking at the table around me that today we're going to talk about roses. It's a big subject. I haven't talked on roses before for a variety of reasons, mostly because it's such a big subject and there's a lot of information to convey and some controversies occasionally. But I think we probably have some upcoming events that we could list. We always do for the beginning of the show. I forgot to discuss that with the support crew in the broadcast room. But let's see, do we have some upcoming events? Let's bring a few up. Yes, the Open Days Program Garden Tour at the Greystone Mansion on Saturday, May 10th from 10 to 4. You'll start off at the Greystone Mansion, and then you're going to see a variety of gardens in the Beverly Hills area. And you'll get to see these private gardens. I believe there's 6 different private gardens. So look that up and put that on your calendar and get an idea of the variety of ways you can landscape your garden here in Southern California, particularly in the West LA area, where it stays a little cooler than the hot inland valleys. In addition to that, we have the annual Epiphyllum pre-sale at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on Saturday, May 17th from 9 to 4. Give them a call at 626-821-4623. Of course, I've talked about Epiphyllums. My Epiphyllums at home are just starting to really put on a lot of blooms, and they are spectacular. This is one of the easiest plants to grow, wonderful cactus. Epiphyllum are the orchid cactus. And they have spectacular flowers. Just knock your socks off. So a wonderful plant material. So get some cuttings and start growing them because you'll just love them for the rest of your life. In addition to that, we have the Sustainable Home and Garden Show, Los Rios Park in San Juan Capistrano, coming up on Saturday, May 17th from 9 to 4. Give them a call at 949-606-6386. To get more information on that and how to garden around your home in a sustainable manner, saving water, saving work, and a variety of other issues when it comes to how to grow a landscape around your home in a sustainable way. In addition to that, we have the Rose Festival coming up at Descanso Gardens on Saturday, May 25th from 9 to 4. Give them a call, look them up. We don't have the number right here for you, but they're a wonderful botanic garden in La Cañada. And they have a very large rose garden and are known for their roses. And a lot of very famous roses were actually bred and developed at Descanso Gardens. Particularly the hybrid tea Chrysler Imperial is famous from Descanso Gardens. And there'll be roses for sale. There'll be lectures on various types of roses and how to take care of your roses. So that would be really a good event to attend if you're into roses or interested in planting some roses around your garden. And let's see, we have something in addition to that? No, that's everything for our upcoming events. And so I'd really strongly encourage you, if you're interested in roses, to go to one of the rose festivals. There's always rose festivals at various botanic gardens. There's rose shows. There's a rose society. They have regular meetings. They have a big rose show at the Arboretum every spring. So a lot of information out there on how to grow roses, what kinds of roses you might want to grow, because there's many, many different kinds of roses. They have been grown for over 5,000 years, and there are many different kinds, and we're going to look at some of the diseases and pests that roses get. We're going to look at, first let's look at the history of roses and the different kinds, because that's all kind of tied together, how they were hybridized and bred and developed. And what people used to grow 5,000 years ago, of course, is very different than what we grow today. So, let's see here. So, As I said, roses were grown as in the temperate latitudes from at least 5,000 years ago. They were known to have been grown in Babylon. There are paintings of roses in Egyptian pyramid tombs that date from the 14th century BC. Records exist of them being grown in Chinese gardens and Greek gardens from at least 500 BC. So you can see that they've been around a long time. Most of the plants grown in these early gardens, of course, were species or what we call wild roses. That is one of the large groups, species roses or wild roses. The significant breeding of modern times started slowly in Europe from about the 17th century. And this was encouraged by the introductions of new species, especially the introduction of the China rose into Europe in the 19th century when it really, really accelerated. In the 1800s was a huge acceleration of rose breeding and development of new types of roses. An enormous range of roses has been bred since then. A major contributor in the early 19th century was Empress Josephine of France, who patronized the development of rose breeding at her gardens in Malmaison. As long ago as 1840, a collection numbering over 1,000 different cultivars, and I've mentioned that term before, cultivar, it means cultivated variety. That means a variety that was developed by man, not a naturally occurring variety. And so 1,000 different cultivars, varieties, and species was possible when a rosarium was planted for Abney Park Cemetery, which was an early Victorian garden cemetery and arboretum in England, and that was in 1840. So that's been quite a long time ago, nearly approaching 200 years ago, over 1,000 different, really different roses. Of course, today there are tens of thousands of different roses. Roses are basically placed in three very large groups. They're either wild roses that I mentioned earlier, or old garden roses, or modern garden roses. The latter two groups are usually subdivided further according to their hybrid lineage, although due to the complex ancestry of most rose hybrids, such distinctions are not really definitive. Roses can end up in several different categories, and I'll explain how that happens. Growth habit and floral form are really kind of dominate these various categories. So the wild roses include natural species and some of their immediate hybrid descendants. The wild roses commonly grown in gardens include Rosa moschata. And let's bring up our first picture, which is Rosa moschata. And I don't have an actual picture of Rosa moschata. I just have this drawing. Let's bring this up full screen. Take a look at this. This is a species rose, Rosa moschata. And oh, my screen is off. So let me see if I can turn it on so I can see it over here. There we go. So this, of course, is a white with a single, it's what we call a single rather than a double because it only has five petals. Another wild or species rose is the musk rose Rosa banksiae, and we can bring up number two. This is Lady Banks rose, and this is a species rose. Rosa pimpelifolia is also a wild rose or a species rose, the Scots or Burnet rose. And let's bring that next picture, number three. This is Rosa pimpinifolia. And you can see this is a single, but this is a species rose. And now Rosa rubiginosa is also our next picture, which is number four. This is also a species rose. This is also referred to as the sweet briar or eglantine rose. Another species rose is Rosa foetida, and that's our next picture, which is number five. This is also called Harrison's yellow. This is a species rose. For most of these, the plants found in cultivation are often selected clones that are propagated vegetatively. So, you know, even though we call these species roses, if you were around 5,000 years ago, you might not have actually found them growing in the wild. Wild roses are low-maintenance shrubs in comparison to other garden roses, usually tolerating poor soil and some shade. They generally only have one flush of blooms per year, although some species have large hips in the autumn, or have colorful autumn foliage. Rosa mochaca is a species of rose long in cultivation. Its wild origins are uncertain, but are suspected to lie in the western Himalayas. And that was the very first picture we showed you. Rosa banksiae, which we showed you, which is Lady Banks rose, or Tombstone rose, or just Banks rose, is a species native to the central and western China in the province of Gansu and quite a few others, all the way to Yunnan, occurring at altitudes of 500 to 2,200 meters, which is 1,600 to 7,000 feet. So that would be a rose that would tolerate quite a bit of cold, you would expect. Rosa pinnifolia, let's go back and bring that back one up, just behind me, not full screen. That's our number three picture. We could move back to that photo. Is a species of rose noted in Western, Central, and Southern Europe. So this is a European species. It's also found in Iceland and Norway and Northwest Africa. It is generally restricted to sand dunes or limestone pavements and typically has a coastal distribution when not on limestone. It is known by several common names, including Austrian briar, Persian yellow rose, and Austrian copper rose, and also known from the Caucasus Mountains in Georgia. It has yellow flowers with a scent, which some find unpleasant. That's the pinnifolia, which is a mouthful. So let's... now there were no yellow roses in Europe at the time when the Foedia were introduced. Let me see, I think I've lost a little bit of my note. So the Foedia rose, let's go back to that number five, which is Harrison's yellow. Also, this is also known as the Oregon Trail Rose and the Yellow Rose of Texas. Although those are hybrid rose cultivars, which originated as a chance hybrid seedling from Rosa foedia. The cultivar first bloomed at the suburban villa of George Harrison, attorney, between 8th and 9th Avenues on 32nd Street, north of New York City. The site of Harrison's villa is now just south of the present General Post Office. So there's a long history of Harrison's yellow, and it is considered a species rose, Rosa foedia. Now, the old garden roses, let's talk about those, because those we just talked a little bit about the wild roses, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on those. But the old garden roses, there's a whole bunch of different kinds, defined as any rose belonging to a class which existed before the introduction of the first modern rose, which was La France. La France was the first hybrid tea rose introduced in 1867. So 1867 is kind of set. Anything before 1867 is an old garden rose. Anything after 1867 is a modern rose. Alternative terms for this group include heritage or historic roses. In general, old garden roses of European or Mediterranean origin are once blooming. Woody shrubs with notably fragrant double-flowered blooms, primarily in shades of white, pink, and crimson red. The shrub's foliage tends to be highly disease-resistant, and they generally bloom only from canes, which formed in previous years. Most garden roses are classified into a number of different groups. We'll talk about those in a minute. So that's really interesting. These old garden roses from Europe have very good disease resistance. And so there was a tendency, of course, when breeding new roses to concentrate on the flower and the scent and not on disease resistance. Luckily, that's changed quite a bit over the last probably 25 years, because disease resistance has become far more important to a lot of home gardeners who don't want to spray their roses all the time for powdery mildew and rust and black spot and other common diseases on roses. Now, the first group of old garden roses are the alba roses, or literally white roses, derived from Rosa arvensis, I should say, and closely allied with the hybrid X alba. The latter species is a hybrid of Gallica and Canina. This group contains some of the oldest garden roses. The shrubs flower once yearly in the spring or early summer with scented blossoms of white or pale pink. And let's bring up an example of that. That would be number seven. This is called Maiden's Blush. Bring that up full screen. And this is an old garden rose in the alba group. They frequently have gray-green foliage and vigorous or climbing habitat of growth. Examples, of course, this is Maiden's Blush, which is an album. There are others. There's also The White Rose of York. Now, the next group of old garden roses are the Gallica roses. The Gallica, or Rose of Provence group, is a very old class developed from Rosa Gallica, which is a native of Central and Southern Europe and Western Asia. The apothecary's rose, Rosa Gallica officinalis, was grown in the Middle Ages in monastic herbaria for its alleged medicinal properties and became famous in English history as the Red Rose of Lancaster. Gallica's flower once in the summer over low shrubs, rarely over 4 feet. Unlike most other once blooming old garden roses, the Gallica class includes shades of red, maroon, deep purplish, crimson. Examples are, let's take a look at a few. Let's take a look at the first one, the Wild Rose Gallica, number 8, and bring that up. Bring that up full screen. And this is a single, and it's this picture is reported to have come from Romania. And we'll take a look at a few more. Let's see what I have for my notes. Well, let's go to our next picture, which is Rosa Gallica officinalis. This is known as the apothecary's rose, really striking color. And let's see what we want to say about this. Let's say a little bit more about Rosa Gallica in general. Forming low, suckering shrubs, the flowers can be single, but most commonly are double or semi-double. The colors range from white to pink to deep purple. All Gallica group roses are once flowering. They are easily cultivated. The species is native to Southern and Central Europe, as I mentioned earlier. Eastwards to Turkey and the Caucasus, plants with semi-double pink flowers have been treated as either a variety under the name Gallica officinalis or as a cultivar Gallica officinalis. It is also called the apothecary's rose, I've said that before, the crimson damask rose, or the red rose of Lancaster. It is the county flower of Lancashire. This is also known as Rosa Mundi. It is easily cultivated in well-drained soil in full sun to semi-shade. It can survive temperatures as low as minus 25 degrees centigrade, which is unbelievably cold. It is one of the earliest cultivated species of roses, cultivated by the Greeks and the Romans, and commonly used in medieval gardens. In the 19th century, it was the most important species of rose to be cultivated, and the most modern European rose cultivars have at least a small contribution from Rosa Gallica in their ancestry. In fact, Gallica actually did repeat bloom a little bit. This is the one rose that actually had a little bit of repeat blooming, but it would bloom in the summer and then repeat a little bit later in the summer, late summer or fall. Now the next group are called the damask roses. Well, let's take a look at another Rosa Gallica first. Let's bring up number 10. This is Charles DeMille. Bring it up full screen. And, you know, what I've noticed about all these old garden roses is they look quite different than what you see in hybrid teas and a lot of roses you're familiar with, is they've got, you know, they don't uncurl when they open the buds. They just kind of open all at once. But they've got a row of flat petals on the outside and these highly curved petals on the interior. So they have this very distinct look to them, and the foliage is a little, you know, quite distinct too from what we would consider a typical rose foliage for a lot of the roses you see in people's gardens these days. So that's Rosa Gallica, Charles DeMille, and this dates from before 1790. So now a lot of these roses are, of course, still widely available in the trade and not hard to find. So if you like this rose, it's out there. Now, our next one is also a Rosa Gallica. This is number 11. This is called Tuscany Superb. Let's bring that up and share that. And you'll see again that kind of similar look to it with a lot of very curly petals. And the foliage is a little bit different than what you expect from these others. Now, our next group are called the damask roses. These originated in ancient times with a natural cross between Rosa moschata and Rosa Gallica. And then further across to another rose. Robert De Beer is given credit for bringing damask roses from the Middle East to Europe sometime between 1254 and 1276, although there is evidence from ancient Roman frescoes that at least one damask rose existed in Europe for hundreds of years before this. Summer damask bloom once in the summer. Autumn or four season damask bloom again later, albeit less exuberantly. And these were the first repeat flowering old European roses. Damask roses tend to have rangy, sprawling growth habits and strongly scented blooms. And let's take a look at our first Rosa Damascus, Damascena. This is number 12. Let's bring that up. If we've got number 12 available, we can take a look at it. But this is known as the Damask Rose, or sometimes the Rose of Castile. It is a rose hybrid derived from Gallica and Mostaca. Further DNA analysis has shown that a third species is also involved in this cross. The flowers are renowned for their fine fragrance and are commercially harvested for rose oil, either rose oto or rose absolute, used in perfumery and to make rose water, and rose concrete, which I have no idea what rose concrete is. The flower petals are also edible. They may be used to flavor food or as a garnish or as an herbal tea, and preserved in sugar as gulkand. I should read more about that. The damask rose is a deciduous shrub growing to 7 feet tall. The stems densely armed with stout curved prickles and stiff bristles. And I might mention that the thorns on roses are not really thorns. They are actually prickles. Now I've got my first caller of the day, and I'm not surprised, because anytime you talk about roses, people want to talk about roses. Let's go to our first caller. So, Mike, calling from Torrance, you're on the air.
Hey, yeah, I'd like to ask you about some growing super hot chili pepper plants.
Okay.
I'd like to know about a fertilizer, nutrients, pesticide.
Well, is there any particular pepper you're interested in? You want to grow something super hot?
Well, I'm going with the Carolina Reaper.
Okay, well, there's a lot of different hot peppers. One of my favorites used to be Floral Gem. If you see that, you might want to try it. It starts out yellow and then blushes kind of a pink and then to orange at the end of the season. But generally speaking, you're going to grow your peppers kind of the same way, regardless of what kind of pepper you grow, whether it's a sweet pepper or a hot pepper. You want to properly space them. Now, some of the hot peppers take a long time to mature. You're buying them in pony packs, or you're growing from seed?
I'm doing them in seeds. I got a heat mat going and
You probably don't need that this time.
Heat moss and
we're awful warm now. They'll germinate just really easily, just in little 4-inch pots or little pony packs or however you grow your seed. You don't really need that heating pad except in the winter when you're trying to grow seed. But it'll probably, they'll germinate a few days early if you have bottom heat. You're going to want to pre-fertilize or mix in a pre-fertilizer into the soil. Are you going to grow them in the ground or in pots?
I'm going to go ahead and do them in 5-gallon pots.
Oh, 5-gallon pots. Well, then I would suggest you use potting soil rather than just a regular garden soil. Anytime you're in a pot, you're creating a whole new environment for the plant. So you'd be much better off purchasing a potting soil. A lot of companies make potting soil. It runs for a 2-cubic-yard bag. You can expect to pay $8 to $10 a bag at Home Depot or Lowe's or Osh or whatever garden store you go to. And you'd be better off with something like that than trying to put, bulk soil from your backyard into a pot, because you're going to have all sorts of problems with that. And then I would probably fertilize them. There'll be a lot of fertilizer in with that potting soil. Potting soils are already pre-fertilized. You're going to want to put them where they get as much sun as possible. I see you're in Torrance, and one thing that peppers need a lot of is heat, and they're going to be slower to develop and mature in a cool environment than opposed to a hot environment. And for instance, New Mexico is the largest producer of hot peppers in the United States. But when you grow them in hot inland valleys like the San Gabriel Valley or all the way out to Riverside, they will mature earlier. The fruit, you know, the peppers themselves will mature and color up quicker than along the coast where it stays cool. So you have to be patient. Have your seedlings come up already?
Yeah, I do. I do have some that came up. I'll just ask another question. How about a shot of magnesium?
It's you know, it won't hurt them, but it's not necessary. They may get a little darker green if you give them a little magnesium. I don't know if that'll make them hotter or not. If you're growing something that's really known, you know, there's a the Colville units is one way to rate them. And I'm trying to recall just offhand, I think jalapenos are around 10,000. Now, jalapeno gets a rating of about a 5 on a 1 to 10 scale. So jalapenos aren't as hot as a lot of other peppers. That Floral Gem I used to grow was up around an 8. And then the habaneros, which are just smoking hot, and so hot I can't eat them, and they are a 10. But there are some that are 10 times hotter than habaneros. So, and you know, up around a million Scoville units.
The Carolina Reaper, I'm doing some Butch Tees, Morago Scorpion, some Ghost. You know, just fun to do. I'm not really going to eat them. Just to give them away and see if someone will eat one if I hand it to them.
Be very careful when you handle them. Just touching the fruit once it's, you know, you pick them. And then touch and rub your eyes, and you're going to really regret that. So be very careful when you handle them. In fact, when I handle really hot peppers like that, I wear gloves, little thin, you know, plastic gloves, because just the pepper on your skin can burn your skin on these really, really hot peppers.
That's true. I have another question for you. It's for a different plant. I'm doing some plumerias also.
Okay.
And I'm doing some cuttings. And, you know, some rooting hormone. I need some rooting hormone with fungicide. I'm trying to find it, and there's no one that has it anymore. Is that true?
Well, I'm surprised. You ought to be able to find that fairly easily at almost any garden center. There's a number of, you know, you don't really need it, to tell you the first off. You don't need rooting hormone to root plumerias. They root easily without it. The key is when you make your cutting, let that cut wound dry for about a week at least. And you don't want to cut it and then put it into a pot the same day, because that can lead to rot. Put it into a pot with, you know, if you use a potting soil, I would cut it maybe 50% with perlite or vermiculite, or so you get really good drainage.
Yeah, I'm using the cactus mix right now.
Cactus mix would be fine.
How about for, like, you know, like the spider mite and stuff? What would you use?
Well, to control spider mites, I just use soap. Dishwashing soap, or safer insecticidal soap, or a horticultural oil. Being in Torrance, you could probably get away with oils most of the year. Oils will burn if it's over 90 degrees, so be careful with oil. Soaps you can use year-round. You want to spray the backs of the leaves thoroughly with your spray, and do that about once a week for about 3 weeks. If you see, now I have a lot of plumeria. I never have a problem with spider mite. I get a lot of spider mite on my tomatoes, but not so much on my plumerias. They like to be in full sun in the hottest part of your garden. A southern exposure or western exposure is best once you get them out into the ground, or even if you have them in pots. If they're in pots, you got to water them more frequently. They don't need a lot of water. I would water them about, if they're established in the ground, I would water them once a month in the spring and the fall, and about every 2 weeks in the summer, especially where you are in Torrance, where it doesn't get very hot. In Pasadena, you might water them every 2 weeks in the spring and once a week in the summer, especially August, September, when we're up in the upper 90s or over 100. They will really respond to fertilizer 3 times a year, your plumerias. But if you can't find any hormone, rooting hormone, which will accelerate the rooting, it's beneficial, it's just not absolutely necessary, you can use aspirin. You can take aspirin and crush it up and, you know, into a powder, and then dust the ends with, you know, the part of the stem you're going to put in the pot. Another little tip is they like to tip over, and they're very hard to keep straight.
Right.
Especially in a pot, that you get them straight like this, and then they just start to tip over, especially once they root and they start to grow and they tip over. So
okay, another question on the plumeria on the leaves. Are we occasionally get a couple like brown spots on them, maybe like a fungus or something? Would like that neem oil help that, or should I use
Well, you could try neem oil, but you know, most likely that's just a physiological problem. I see it often on older leaves that are starting to senesce. If you see that on brand new leaves that are just starting to grow, then that would probably be some type of leaf spot fungus. There's a bunch of different types of fungus that cause leaf spots. But on older leaves that are starting to get old, you're going to get those kind of spots no matter what you spray on your plant. That's just natural and normal.
And, another question on those plumies. How about when the leaves start to curl? Even with the new leaves coming out, occasionally some will curl?
I doubt if that's something you could actually control a whole lot. You know, it might. I haven't seen that on my own. I've got quite a few. I'm really a big fan of plumerias. I've got rainbows and, you know, all sorts of different named cultivars. They're real fun. They're incredibly fragrant.
Hawaii.
And remember, they're dormant.
Really
they go dormant in the winter, and you don't water them at all.
Yeah, I got a little greenhouse going in the back here, too, and we're trying to get some humid in there. And
Well, Torrance is plenty humid. They don't need to be in a greenhouse.
All the different colors of them. I love gardening. I watch the show all the time.
Oh, well, thanks for watching. And, you know, I would go back to your peppers. I would fertilize them probably about every other month through the growing season. And you could probably use almost any fertilizer, but typically I would use something that promotes flowering, you know, like a, you could even use a 10-10-10 or a 10-15-10, 10-15-15, or some kind of flower fertilizer or vegetable fertilizer. Because you don't want to put like a lawn fertilizer on, like a 30-10-10. You want to use something
balanced.
Something either balanced or specifically for flowering and fruit production. Things that you put on fruit trees and in vegetable gardens and roses, you know, because if you put a lot of nitrogen, you're getting a lot of growth and less fruit, less flowering.
Right.
I would fertilize them every other month if they're in a pot.
Every other month. Okay. And on sulfur is a good additive too, correct?
Well, sulfur, if you want to dust, you know, a lot of people dust cuttings with sulfur before they try and root them. And that's to control any rot or, you know, decay. And it works. It's very effective. If you mix sulfur in with your potting mix, the purpose is to acidify the soil. And I don't know, I'd have to go back and specifically read about plumerias, I don't think they really require an acid soil like a lot of other plants. Like azaleas and blueberries really need an acid soil. Or they'll go bright yellow on you because they don't get enough iron. I don't think plumerias have that problem, but they would probably benefit from lowering the pH from 8 to 7. They don't necessarily need to get down to 5.5 like you would for blueberries or azaleas.
Uh-huh. And on tomatoes, I noticed after all this wind and heat we had, all my flowers stood on this year. I went in and threw some gypsum in the soil, turned it up, even put some chicken manure down in there. And it seems like it's helping. And then I put some other organic nutrients in there. And I turned it up and I soaked
a while. That blast of heat we had over the last week could easily have knocked the blooms off of tomatoes. Now, I got about 16 tomatoes in this year, which is the most I've ever grown. It's a lot of tomatoes, and I mean, don't know what I'm going to do with them all in July and August. But I didn't lose any flowers, and I was up to 100 degrees 4 days in a row this last week. And they wilted during the day, but they came back every night because they weren't used to that kind of heat. It had been cool, you know.
Right.
And suddenly you go from being in the 70s to being, you know, at really 99 degrees, 100 degrees, and they wilted during the day. But at night they came, you know, as soon as it cooled off, they came right back up and were, you know, turgid and vigorous. But I didn't lose any flowers.
I noticed one leaf had a little bit of powdery mildew on it, so I went ahead and snipped it off. And
it's always a good idea.
Anything else left.
In fact, that's one of the best ways to kind of, if you're monitoring your plant material on a regular basis, so once a week or a few times a week, and you see either powdery mildew starting up, doesn't matter what the host is, or if you're looking at roses, you see a little rust starting, get those infected leaves off and into the trash because those are the source of the inoculum to multiply the disease through the season.
And what would you spray to control that sort of stuff there?
You mean powdery mildew?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Well, there's milk and water is very effective at controlling powdery mildew, anywhere from 10% up to 50%, and any milk product will do. And also there's a fairly new fungicide from Kellogg, which is potassium bicarbonate. Sodium bicarbonate may work a little bit, but not like it's not going to be as effective as potassium bicarbonate. I don't know what Kellogg is calling their fungicide. It's a registered fungicide, organically labeled, so you can use it on squash. Squash have a big problem with powdery mildew. But you can either use the milk and water, or you could use that potassium bicarbonate, or you could use neem oil if it's not over 90 degrees.
Well, that's great. You know, it's just fun going out there and enjoying your plants and watching them grow and figuring out they want.
It's a lot of fun. Well, thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. So, well, it's good always to hear from an enthusiastic gardener. I got to admit that last year I skipped my vegetable garden. I was busy and I didn't have time to get it in the spring. And then once it got later into the year, I just said, I'm going to let my vegetable garden go fallow and I'll just concentrate on taking care of my fruit trees. And this spring, February, I got everything in early. I got my tomatoes in, I got my squash in, I got peppers in a few weeks ago. A couple different kinds of peppers. I'm growing a lot of sweet peppers from sweet seed, which is a lot of fun to grow from seed. Growing some sunflowers from seed, which is fun. A lot of lettuce from seed. So I agree 100%. It is just a lot of fun to get out there and get in the garden. And it's a lot of hard work at first, but once the plants start to take off and get some size and you see it blooming and the fruit setting, it's heaven. It's just a lot of fun. So let's get back and talk a little bit more about roses. Because roses have a lot of problems, but let's talk about we're really kind of looking at the history of roses here. We were talking about the Damask roses, and we had Rosa Damascena up. Let's take a look at Autumn Damask, which is number 13. And I think I misspoke earlier when I said the Gallicas repeat bloom. It's the Damask roses that repeat bloom. And bring this up full screen. This is Autumn Damask, or it's also referred to as Quatre Saisons. And that's because it blooms, you know, it repeat blooms. And that was a great characteristic to breed into the European roses, because they would just bloom once and then they wouldn't bloom again. So the Damask roses were brought into Europe in the 1200s. But it was believed they could have been there much earlier. So this is the Autumn Damask, and they are renowned for their very fine fragrance and commercially harvested for rose oil. And let's see, I think I've kind of covered that. So let's take a look at our next one. This is actually a famous old Damask, Ispahan. And let's take that up, number 14, Rosa Ispahan. This is also known as Papon de Princesse, is a clear pink, half-open kind of Damask rose, introduced from the Middle East in European breeding during the crusading 13th century. This is still highly recommended, particularly by David Austin, among the first old roses to start blooming and the last to continue, and for its fine Damask fragrance. The name Ispahan is from the name of the city, Isfahan in Iran. The flowers tend to grow in pairs, so a very nice old rose. The next group of roses that are considered old roses are the Centifolia roses, also known as cabbage roses or province roses. Let's bring up number 15. And this is what they call a cabbage rose. They are named for their 100 petals, and they are often and they kind of look like a cabbage due to the globular shape of the flowers. The result of Damask roses crossed with albas, the centifolias are all once flowering. As a class, they are notable for their inclination to produce mutations of various sizes and forms, including moss roses and some of the first miniature roses. So what do we have here? We have centifolia. This is actually a drawing of it. Our next picture, 16, is actual a photograph of centifolia. And this is a hybrid developed by Dutch rose breeders in the periods between the 17th and 19th century, possibly earlier. It is a complex hybrid bred from Rosa Gallica, Rosa Machaca, Rosa Canea, and Rosa Damascena. Its exact heredity history is not well documented. Of course, people crossed it a long time ago. Individual plants are shrubby in appearance, growing 1.5 to 2 meters in height, with long drooping canes and grayish-green pinnate leaves with 5 to 7 leaflets. The flowers are round and globular, with numerous thin overlapping petals that are highly scented. They are usually pink, less often white, to dark red-purple. This centifolia, which you see behind me, is particular to the French city of Grasse, known as the perfumed capital of the world. It is widely cultivated for its singular fragrance, clear and sweet with light notes of honey. The flowers are commercially harvested for the production of rose oil, which is commonly used in perfumery. Let's move on to the moss roses. The moss roses are based on a mutation from Rosa centifolia. And maybe I should mention that one of the things that roses do, and a lot of plants do, is they sport, or they have a mutation. And you'll have a cane or a branch that has a different flower or different foliage. It can be either or both. And so in this case, there was a sport, or it's also sometimes referred to as a chimera, that came off of a Rosa centifolia. And so that was cut and propagated and became known as a moss rose. They bear mossy resin-bearing glands on the sepals that often gives off a pleasant woodsy or balsam scent when rubbed. Moss roses are cherished for this unique trait, but as a group, they have not contributed further to development of new rose classifications. Moss roses with centifolia background are once flowering. Some moss roses exhibit repeat blooming, indicative of autumn damask parentage. Now, this one is called the common moss, and that's the only picture I have of a moss. But there are quite a few more moss roses. Now, the Portland rose group were long thought to be the first group of crosses between China roses and European roses, and to show the influence of Rosa chinensis. Recent DNA analysis, however, has demonstrated that the original Portland rose does not have Chinese hereditary or ancestry, but has an autumn damask gallica lineage. This group of roses was named after the Duchess of Portland, not Portland, Oregon, who received a rose then known as Rosa pestana, or scarlet four seasons rose, now known simply as the Portland rose. So let's bring up the Portland rose. This is number 18. We'll take a look at what it looks like. The whole class of Portland roses was developed from that one rose. The first repeat flowering class of rose with fancy European-style blossoms. The plants tend to be fairly short and shrubby, with a suckering habit with proportionally short flower stalks. Do we have number 18 available? Let's bring that up. The main flowering is in the summer, but intermittent flowers continue into the autumn. And this is the Portland rose right here. Our next one is another Portland rose called James Veitch. Or it could be Vitek, I guess. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. But let's take a look at number 19, which is also a Portland rose, and really quite a showy rose. So now let's move on to the China roses. The China roses are based on Rosa chinensis and have been cultivated in East Asia for centuries, probably actually thousands of years. They have been cultivated in Western Europe since the late 18th century. They contribute much to the parentage of today's hybrid roses, and they brought a change to the form of the flowers then cultivated in Europe. Compared with the older rose classes known in Europe, the Chinese roses had less fragrance. Smaller blooms carried over twiggy, more cold-sensitive shrubs. However, they could bloom repeatedly throughout the summer and into late autumn, unlike their European cousins. The flowers of China roses were also notable for their tendency to suntan or darken over time, unlike other blooms, which tended to fade after opening. So let's take a look at a China rose. The first one we're going to look at is Rosa mutabilis, the butterfly rose. Let's bring that up. And this is a really fun rose. This is known prior to 1894. This most interesting rose was once sold as Tipo Ideal, and it is ideally suited to illustrate the typical China trait of darkening with age instead of fading. And so you can see here on this, there's many different colors. There's these pinks and these yellows. But what happens is they start yellow and then they turn, and as they age, they turn dark pink. They're not really different flowers. It's the same flower that changes color over time. So let's take a look at our next picture, 21, and we'll get a close-up of this rose. And you can see this is the older rose. This is the young rose. And so this is kind of a light yellow, and it turns to a kind of a rose pink or an orchid pink. And let's read a little bit more about this particular rose. This is Rosa mutabilis, whose single petals open sulfur yellow, changing through orange to a rich pink and finally crimson. Bright, silky flowers of all these colors will often be on display at the same time, looking as if a group of multicolored butterflies has settled on the bush, and that's why it's known as the butterfly rose. This aspect earned mutabilis its common name, the butterfly rose. A healthy, well-branched shrub, mutabilis will easily grow to 6 feet, making a fine specimen plant whose showy flowers are accented by the bronze color of the new growth. This is a very popular rose due to its distinct coloration. So we have another, also another old China rose, or a China rose, and that's number 22, Parsons Pink. Let's take a look at Parsons Pink, or it's also known as Old Blush. This is also a China rose. And let's see what else we have here for China roses. I want to just take a quick look here. And this is another China rose we have here, which is, and I'm going to mispronounce this, Cramoisi Superior. Let's bring up number 23 and take a quick look at that. This is another China rose. And I think they'll pronounce it correctly in this video clip I have. Let's go to our first video clip. Now, this is a nice clip, and it shows a lot of the roses I've already talked about, but this is your chance to get a pad and paper. If you're interested in growing some old garden roses that you know are hundreds of years old and have very good disease resistance. The nice thing about these roses, even though they don't repeat bloom, maybe you've got a little spot in your garden where you don't need it to bloom constantly. And so you might be interested in growing some of these heritage roses, antique roses, or what we call old garden roses. Let's take a look at this first video clip. It'll show you the roses right up close and show you their growth habit, which they're kind of rangy, shrubby. They don't look like a lot of the roses you think about. They don't look like a hybrid tea. They don't look like a grandiflora. They don't look like floribunda. Those are modern roses. Let's go to our first video clip.
Hi, I'm Pam Collins, Director of Gardens in the Department of Plant and Soil Sciences at Mississippi State University. We are at the Veterans Memorial Rose Garden, where I'd like to show you a variety of old garden roses. The first rose I want to show you today is a damask rose called Kazanlik. It's a large, wild-growing shrub, and it blooms only in the spring. This rose has a soft pink bloom, slightly double in form, and the foliage is rough and sage green. The second cultivar I'd like to show you comes from Germany in the 1930s. Its name is Dr. Eichener, and it is a hybrid rugosa rose. The blooms on Dr. Eichener are very large, and they're fragrant, and they repeat bloom throughout the season. One of the nice aspects of Dr. Eichener is that the blooms range from a deep peach pink to a pale soft pink as they age. This shrub also is large and coarsely growing, and the thorns are really vicious. It tolerates poor soils as well. The foliage that you see on Dr. Eichener is very typical of hybrid rugosas. The surface of the leaf is very rough and rugged and has a lot of veins prominent on the surface. an example of roses that are derived from warmer climates, such as are found throughout the southern part of Europe, the Middle East, or the Far East, is Pax. Pax is a hybrid musk rose that was developed in England in 1918, and that's an appropriate name for peace at the end of World War I. The shrub is large and has long arching stems and lacks growth habit that makes it nice to prop up against a fence. The blooms are a semi-double white, and they bloom continuously throughout the year. Again, this plant will tolerate poor soils. This is an example of a China rose. Its name is Rosa chinensis mutabilis, or butterfly rose. It's large, it's very twiggy, and it has very healthy foliage, and it makes a good landscape shrub. The flowers are single, and they range in color from dark pink to pale yellow. Another example of a China rose is Cramoisie superior, which was developed in France in 1832. It's a smaller shrub and makes it more useful in smaller garden spaces. The flowers are dark red, they're semi-double, and they are produced in large clusters. Again, the bloom is continuous throughout the garden season. Another rose of very ancient garden origins is Rosa banksia lutea, or Lady Banks rose. It was imported in the early 1820s. The foliage is elegant, it's small, it has very healthy black spot resistant leaves that are semi-evergreen in Mississippi. It is a large rose and it needs to grow on a sturdy trellis. It's the first rose to bloom in the garden in spring, and it makes a great landscape plant. Another large climbing China rose is Cecile Bruner, also known as the sweetheart rose. It is a large and robust climber. It blooms in the spring only with many soft pink blooms and lovely buds. The foliage is healthy and it's abundant. The final cultivar I want to show you today is a tea rose called Duchess de Brabant. The growth habit is spreading and graceful, and there's abundant foliage. And this plant is very suitable for smaller garden spaces. The blooms are highly double, they're rose pink, they're very shapely, and they're cupped in their form. This plant will bloom throughout the season, and it needs a sunny, warm place to thrive. Spring has arrived, and we've seen plenty of color this afternoon. As you consider roses to include in your own garden, consider some of these cultivars to use as landscape shrubs. I'm Pam Collins for Gardening Through the Seasons.
So that just shows you some of the roses I was talking about, but I've got some more to talk about. We were talking about the China roses, and we showed mutabilis, and that, if I pronounce it correctly this time, I'm going to pronounce it wrong again. So let's talk about the original tea-scented Chinas, Rosa ex odorata, were oriental cultivars thought to represent hybrids of Rosa chinensis and Rosa gigantea, a large Asian climbing rose with pale yellow blossoms. Immediately upon their introduction in the early 19th century, breeders went to work with them, especially in France, crossing them first with China roses and then with bourbons and nosetias. I'm going to pronounce that wrong too. The tea roses are repeat flowering roses, named for their fragrance being reminiscent of Chinese black tea, although this is really not the case. The color range includes pastels, shades of white and pink, and yellow to apricot. The individual flowers of many cultivars are semi-pendant and nodding due to weak flower stalks. In a typical tea, pointed buds produce high-centered blossoms which unfurl in a spiral fashion, and the petals tend to roll back at the edges, producing a petal with a pointed tip. The teas are thus the originators of today's classic florist roses. And according to rose historians, Brent Dickerson, the tea classification owes much to marketing as to botany. 19th century nurserymen would label their Asian-based cultivars as teas if they possessed the desirable tea flower form, and Chinas if they did not. Like the Chinas, the teas are not hardy in colder climates. Examples, let's take a look at some of these tea roses. Our next one is 24, Lady Hillington is an example of a tea-scented China rose. And there you have it in a little cluster. And let's take a look at 25, which is also Lady Hillington, and see if I have another one. Now we're going to move on to the bourbon roses in a minute. This is one of the early tea roses. And our next group are called the bourbon roses. They originated on the Ile Bourbon, now called Réunion, off the coast of Madagascar in the Indian Ocean. They are believed to be the result of a cross between Autumn Damask and the old blush China rose, both of which were frequently used as materials on the island. They flower repeatedly on vigorous, frequently semi-climbing shrubs with glossy foliage and purple-tinted canes. First introduced in France in 1823. And let's take a look at a bourbon rose. This is Louis Audier, number 26. And this is a bourbon rose. Bring that up, full screen. And let's see what else we have for that. Another bourbon is Souvenir de la Malmaison, which is 27. Let's take a look at that one. So this is another bourbon rose. Now the next group are called Nocette. The first Nocette rose was raised as a hybrid seedling by a South Carolina rice planter named John Champanis. Its parents were the China rose Parsons Pink and the autumn flowering musk rose Rosa Moschata, resulting in a vigorous climbing rose producing huge clusters of small pink flowers from spring to fall. Let's take a look at our first one of that, which is Desprez à la Fleurs Jaunes, if I pronounced that right. That's number 28. And let's see if I've got it. So this is what they call a Nocette rose, or Nocette. I'm not sure exactly how that should be pronounced. A small blossom, fairly winter-hardy climbers, but later infusions of tea rose genes created a T. Nocette subclass with larger flowers, smaller clusters, and considerably reduced winter hardiness. So, after that, we have the hybrid perpetual roses. And let's see if we can take a look at a hybrid perpetual. This is La Reine. Let's bring that up, number 29. And the dominant class of roses in Victorian England, hybrid perpetuals, emerged in 1838 as the first roses which successfully combined Asian repeat blooming with the old European lineages. Since reblooming is a recessive trait, the first generation of crosses were stubbornly once blooming, but when these crosses were recrossed with themselves or with China or teas, some of their offspring flowered more than once. The hybrid perpetuals thus were something of a catch-all class derived to a great extent from the Bourbons, but with admixtures of China's teas, Damask, Gallicus, and to a lesser extent, Nocettes, Albas, and even Centifolias. They became the most popular garden and florist roses of Northern Europe at the time, as the tender tea roses would not thrive in cold climates, and the hybrid perpetuals, very large blooms, were well suited to the new phenomenon of competitive exhibitions. The perpetual in the name hints at repeat flowering, but many varieties of this class had poor reflowering habits. The tendency was for a massive spring bloom followed by either scattered summer flowering, a small autumn burst, or sometimes nothing at all during the next spring, until the next spring. Due to limited color palette, white, pink, and red, and lack of reliable repeat bloom, her hybrid perpetuals were ultimately overshadowed by their descendants, the hybrid teas. And let's see if we have another hybrid repeat, which is number 30. This is Ferdinand Richard, is a hybrid perpetual, if you bring that up. And very similar to that Gallica rose that we saw earlier, which is also white striped, white with pink stripes. Now the next group are the hybrid musk roses. And we can bring up number 31, which is Buff Butterfly. This is a hybrid musk. They arose too late to qualify technically as old garden roses. The hybrid musks are often informally classed with them since their growth habits and care are much more like the old garden roses than modern roses. The hybrid musk group was mainly developed by Reverend Joseph Pemberton, a British rosarian, in the first decades of the 20th century based upon Agalia, an 1896 cross by Peter Lambert. A seedling of this rose, Trier is considered to be the foundation of the class. The genetics of the class are somewhat obscure, as some of the parents are unknown. Rose multiflora, however, is known to be one parent, and Rosa mosacha, the musk rose, also figures in its heritage, though it is considered to be less important than the name would suggest. Hybrid musks are disease resistant, repeat flowering, and generally clustered flowered with strong characteristic musk scent. The stems tend to be lax and arching with limited thorns. And this is a buff butterfly and really a very lovely rose, nice rose. Now the other rose that we also saw mentioned just recently in that video clip is the hybrid rugosa roses. The rugosas likewise are not officially old garden roses, but tend to be grouped with them because they are similar in growth habitat and form. Derived from Rosa rugosa from Japan and Korea beginning in the 1880s, these vigorous roses are extremely hardy with excellent disease resistance. Most are extremely fragrant, repeat bloomers with moderately double flat flowers. And let's take a look at 32, which is Blanc Double de Coubert from 1893. The defining characteristics of a hybrid rugosa, a rose, is its wrinkly leaves, but some hybrids do lack this trait. These roses will often set hips, examples. There's a handful of examples. Now, there's also a group called the Bermuda roses, and they also Bermuda mystery roses. This is a group of several dozen found roses grown in Bermuda for the last century. The roses have significant value and interest for those growing roses in tropical and semi-tropical regions, since they are highly resistant to both nematode damage and the fungal diseases that plague roses in culture in hot, humid areas. They are also capable of thriving in the hot, humid weather. Most of these roses are thought to be old garden rose cultivars that have otherwise dropped out of cultivation or sports thereof. They are mystery roses because their proper historical names have been lost. Now, there are also some miscellaneous roses. There are Scots and Sweet Briar and some climbing classes of old roses, including Ashire, Climbing China, Lava Gata, Sempervirens, Climbing Tea, and Climbing Bourbon. Those classes with both climbing and shrub forms are often grouped together. Now let's talk about the modern, before we move on to the modern garden roses, I have another video clip. And this is our second video clip, Old Garden and Moss Roses. This is an interesting clip because it just has a music background and text. And so the text, you got to read the text fairly quickly because they don't give you a lot of time to read it. But this will show you a lot of really nice roses and some historical context for each rose. So let's take a look at this next video clip, Old Garden and Moss Roses. Thank you. like that clip. That's, you know, a lot of times I look for clips, and I get them all off YouTube, really. I don't make my own clips, because I think there's really excellent videos out there available, already made, and why repeat the effort? But that's a nice clip. It shows you a lot of old garden roses, and if you want to take a look at that again, it's on YouTube. And it's called Old Garden and Moss Roses. And we have another clip very similar to that coming up on hybrid roses. But let's take a look. Let's talk about some more. Let's talk about the modern garden roses. And the classification of modern roses can be a little confusing, because many modern roses have old garden roses in their ancestry, and their form varies quite a bit. So the classifications tend to be by growth and flowering characteristics. The following include the most notable and popular classifications. And of course, the hybrid tea, which is a great rose, a group. I really enjoy them a lot. As a favorite rose for much of the history of modern roses, hybrid teas were initially created by hybridizing hybrid perpetuals with tea roses in the late 19th century. La France, created in 1867, is universally acknowledged as the first indication of a new class of roses. Let's take a look at La France. That's our next picture. I believe that should be 33. Hybrid teas exhibit traits midway between both parents, hardier than the teas, but less hardy than the hybrid perpetuals, and more ever-blooming than the hybrid perpetuals, but less so than the teas. The flowers are well-formed with large, high-centered buds, and each flowering stem typically terminates in a single shapely bloom. And that is, one of the main characteristics of hybrid teas is a single bloom at the end of the stem. Let's see if we can bring up La France. I believe that's number 33. So this is La France is a famous hybrid tea because it was the first. Bring that up full screen. There it is, there's La France. And so if you were into historical roses, this would be an important one to grow in your historical rose garden. The shrubs tend to be stiffly upright and sparsely foliated, which today is often seen as a liability because it makes them more difficult to place in the garden or landscape. Hybrid teas became the single most popular garden rose of the 20th century. Today, their reputation as high-maintenance plants has led to a decline in their popularity. The hybrid tea remains the standard rose of the floral industry, however, and is still favored in formal situations. So now we're going to take a look at them. These are probably the most common roses you're going to see throughout anyone's garden, because they were so popular for so long, and they still are very popular, and there's some very famous ones. Then now we're going to look at this next rose. Let's bring it up, number 34, the Peace Rose. Actually, before we bring this up full screen, let me just say that La France is a rose developed in 1867 and considered the first hybrid tea. Light pink flowers are with up to 60 petals and a strong fragrance. The Peace Rose, bring this up full screen. The Peace Rose, actually correctly called Madame à Milande, is a well-known and successful garden rose. Over 100 million plants have been sold as of 1992. It is a hybrid tea rose with large flowers of a light yellow to cream color, slightly flushed at the petal edges with crimson pink. It is hardy and vigorous and relatively resistant to disease, making it popular in gardens as well as in the floral trade. Can we bring this up full screen? Because it's just a spectacular bud. And this is what peace looks like when it's in a bud form, when it's just starting to open. It's really quite yellow. And as it opens up, it fades to a light yellow or even almost a white. Developed by French horticulturist Francis Milande in the years 1935 to 1939. When Milande foresaw the German invasion of France, he sent cuttings to friends in Italy, Turkey, Germany, and the United States to protect the new rose. It is said that it was sent to the U.S. on the last plane available for the German invasion, where it was safely propagated by Conrad Pyle Company during the war. Now, let's go to our next picture, which is 35. This is also peace. Go to our next picture, 35. And bring that up. And you can see that the color fades a little bit. As it opens up, it loses that deep yellow. And now take a look here. And this is peace right here in front of me from I have a peace rose. Actually, it's next door in my mother's garden. But this is the peace rose right here. If we come back to me, I'll show you some peace roses from my mom's garden that I cut this morning. Here they are. Maybe you could come in from our camera over here and take a close look at this. This is peace, and I think it's a fabulous rose. It is a hybrid tea, but it has good disease resistance. I don't, you know, get a little powdery mildew on it. I never see black spot. I don't see any rust on it at all, and I didn't see any rust on it this morning. So this is, now you can see they go really all the way to white once they've fully opened. And the heat we had this week might have influenced that a little bit too. You can actually see a little burning here on this flower right here. You see this little this edge here? That actually is the burn from when it hit 100 degrees during the week. And I'll tell you, once it gets that hot, roses will burn. That's, you know, when you get over 100 degrees, it's hard on roses. So this is peace. And it said that at the end of the war, the developer decided to name it after one of the generals from the war, and he didn't want it named after him. He said it'd be better to call it Peace to symbolize the end of World War II. So if you've heard of the Peace hybrid tea, why it's called Peace is it's actually to commemorate the end of World War II. So that's interesting. I didn't know that until just in the last couple weeks. Our next hybrid tea is called Double Delight, developed by Swim and Ellis and introduced in 1977. Grows to, well, they always give this in centimeters, 90 centimeters to 150 centimeters. Blooms repeatedly and has strongly fragrant white flowers with dark red edges. The flowers have up to 30 petals. This is absolutely stunner. Really, really beautiful and commonly available in the trade. The next one is we want to look at is number 37. This is Peer Gynt. This is another hybrid tea with nice yellow, 4.5-inch blooms with red edging. Although you can't see it in this photograph. Repeat bloomer that will bring a ray of sunshine to your garden. Petals of 50. A garden party is our next one. Oh, I'm sorry. No wonder. This is garden party. You're looking now at garden party. I have my notes reversed. This is garden party. This is also, this was created by Swim in 59. The double-shaped flowers are creamy white with pink on the ends and have 25 to 28 petals. Blooms repeatedly during the season. The next one is Peer Gynt. Let's take a look at 38 is Peer Gynt. And this is a yellow, and this is actually quite yellow. Repeat bloomer and a very nice hybrid tea. The next one I'm going to show you, I photographed during the week, 39, Donna Darling. Now there's a really nice nursery over along the 605 called Coiners, and I photographed this during the week, actually. This is Donna Darling, and if we take a look at number 40, it's also Donna Darling. Iridescent red fading to pale yellow on a vigorous disease-resistant bush with lush green foliage. And then our next one we want to take a look at, this is another hybrid tea. The next one we're going to look at is Olympiad. An Olympiad, exquisite blooms of pure red with all the qualities of a great exhibition rose and prolific enough so that it can be depended upon for cuttings all season long. The plants are tall, long-stemmed, and covered with fairly light green, heavily toothed foliage that is probably the most mildew-resistant in its class. Sam McGreedy had a strong belief that roses should be fragrant. Alas, this one has little fragrance. But it didn't stop it from being the best-selling red rose for most of the last 20 years. Fragrance Light, introduced in 1984. Now, next one we want to look at is another hybrid tea. We're going to look at a few of them because they are really dominated. Hybrid teas really dominated rose gardens in California for 50 years. And this next one is Chrysler Imperial. Bring that up full screen. And Chrysler Imperial is strongly fragrant, dark red. This variety was bred and publicly debuted by Walter Lammerts of Descanso Gardens, La Cañada, in 1952. The parents were Charlotte Armstrong and Mirandi, and are both All-American Rose selections in 1940 and 1945. elegantly tapered buds opened into a high-centered blossoms with a diameter of about 11 to 13 centimeters, about 5 inches, and can have up to 45 to 50 petals, which is a high number for a hybrid tea. With a rich, deep, velvety red color, the cultivar flushes in a chronological blooming pattern throughout its local season. Starting in late spring until fall, the long-stemmed rose flowers are long-lasting and showy and make excellent cut flowers. And hybrid teas are really some of your best cut flowers. The big, large flowers on a single stalk. Let's see what else they have to say about Chrysler Imperial. The fragrance is fabulous. It's really a very, very fragrant bloom. And it's said that when this rose was introduced, Chrysler Imperial came in and asked him to name it Chrysler Imperial, and then gave him two Chrysler Imperial cars after he named it Chrysler Imperial. I see we have a caller. Let's go to our next caller. Terry, calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
I have a question about my climbing rose bush. I have a rose bush that's climbed.
Okay.
And I was wondering, how much do you have to water, ma'am?
Well, in general, roses should be watered deeply and infrequently. You should not water them like a lawn, which is shallow and frequent. So I would, depending on, you're in South Pasadena, the San Gabriel Valley, hot inland valley, I would water them probably, you know, during the winter, in the absence of rain, you would water once a month. Starting in March, you might also only water once during the month, but then you start slowly stepping that up as the spring goes along. In April, after about 3 weeks, 3 weeks later, water again in May. In June, you'll probably move it up to 2 weeks. As you get into July, probably every 2 weeks. And then in August and September, when you get really hot, you might need to water once a week. If we have an extreme heat wave, you might have to water twice during the week. But remember, when you water, when you water, you water long enough to soak the soil to a depth of about 18 to 24 inches. Roses are generally smaller shrubs, not large shrubs. And so they're not going to be as deep rooted as a large shrub or a large tree. But you do want to soak the soil well. So I would give them about 2 to 3 inches of water every time I water. So that's going to take, if you just let the hose dribble under them, then it's going to take an hour or so, maybe even 2 hours, depending on how little you're dribbling the hose. That's a hard way to measure. But if avoid watering the foliage, just water the ground under the rose. That's a very good and a very important advice for growing roses or a lot of shrubs, because if you get the foliage wet repeatedly, you're just going to encourage some of the foliar diseases that you'll get, powdery mildew, rust, black spot. Although black spot is really a minimal problem in California in general. It's a humid area disease, so it's a big problem throughout the southern United States. But anyway, deep water them. If you've pruned your roses back hard during the winter, especially the hybrid teas, the grandiflora, the floribundas, or even your species roses or old garden roses, they're not going to have a lot of foliage on them on March 1st. They don't need a lot of water, so a good deep soak will probably last them the whole month. Now, you could go every 2 weeks as well. I mean, but the really important thing is don't water them 3 times a week and don't water them shallow. So deep water them, give them a few weeks to drain and dry out, and then you can water them again. For a large climbing rose, I might water a little deeper than a smaller shrub rose.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. That's really good information. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you for calling in, and thank you for watching the show. And I have a little clip if we get to it that I'm going to, I don't normally pick up clips off YouTube, video clips, just so I can criticize them. But there's plenty on there that can be criticized. But I had to get this one, and we'll look at it later if I get a chance, because there's still a lot to talk about. So we were talking about hybrid teas, and we were just looking at Chrysler Imperial. And then another really, really nice rose is the Chicago Peace, a color variant of the most famous rose of all time that was discovered in the Windy City of Chicago. Bring it up full screen. Really, really pretty flower. The pink edge of peace becomes deeper and sometimes suffuses the entire surface of the petals. And the reverse is a deep, rich gold. a rather unstable sport, and to keep your plant pure, cut the revisions to the point of origin. Same rugged plant and foliage as peace. So this is a sport or a chimera that occurred off peace. And it was introduced in 1962. So, you know, if you're really watching your roses and you see a completely different flower on your rose bush, you probably have, you know, a sport or a chimera. The next group after the hybrid teas are the Perntiana. The French breeder Joseph Pernet Ducher initiated the first class of roses to include genes from old Austrian briar rose, Rosa foetida, with his 1900 introduction of Sol d'Or. Let's take a look at Sol d'Or. It's a really lovely apricot, or almost orange. This resulted in an entirely new color range for roses, shades of deep yellow, apricot, copper, orange, true scarlet, yellow bicolors, lavender, gray, and even brown are now possible with his breeding. Originally considered a separate class, the Pernitianas, or hybrid foetidas, were officially merged into the hybrid teas in 1930. So you could consider this a hybrid tea, but it has a little different history. The new color range did much to increase hybrid tea popularity in the 20th century, but these colors came at a price. Rosa foetida also passed on a tendency towards disease susceptibility, scentless blooms, and intolerance of pruning to its descendants. So this is this one behind me, Sol d'Or, bred in France, 1900, the first of its class. Now, the next ones we want to talk about are the polyanthus. And let's take a look at our 45, let's bring that up. Polyanthus, literally, that means many-flowered roses from the Greek poly and anthos, flower. Originally derived from crosses between two East Asian species, Rosa chinensis and Rosa multiflora, polyanthus first appeared in France in the late 19th century alongside the hybrid teas. They featured short plants, some compact, others spreading, with tiny blooms, about 1 inch in diameter. Carried in long sprays in the typical rose colors of white, pink, and red, their main claim to fame was their prolific bloom. From spring to fall, a healthy polyantha shrub might be literally covered in flowers, creating a strong color impact in the landscape. Polyantha roses are still regarded as low-maintenance, disease-resistant garden roses and remain popular for that reason. And what we see here is Cecil Bruner. And Cecil Bruner can be purchased either as a shrub or as a climbing rose. And they have little tiny flowers, but they are just covered with them, and so they make a good landscape rose. This is the, and Cecil Bruner is described as a sweetheart rose of your grandmother's garden, lightly scented, soft pink, miniature hybrid T-shaped 1.5 inch blooms, possibly the most well-known of all of old roses. It's not really an old rose. This is a modern rose, but it was grown a long time ago. The blooms burst forth on a compact, continual blooming, nearly thornless bush from spring until fall. And thornless is a big plus for me. I get tired of scratching myself up pruning my roses. And hybrid teas usually have a lot of, well, they're actually called prickles. They're not really thorns. Now the next polyantha is Anne Harkness. And this has a wonderful color to it. Let's take a look at 46. Oh, I'm sorry, Anne Harkness is actually a floribunda. And so let's talk about floribundas before we move on to and take a look at Anne Harkness. Some rose breeders saw potential in crossing polyanthus with hybrid teas to create cross roses that bloomed with polyantha profusion, but with hybrid tea floral beauty and color range. In 1907, the first polyantha hybrid tea cross was introduced. This had some characteristics of both parent classes and were termed a hybrid polyantha or Poulsen rose. Further similar introductions followed from Poulsen, these often bearing the family name Else Poulsen. As the hybrid characteristics separated these new roses from polyanthus and hybrid teas alike, a new class was created named Floribunda, Latin for mini flowering. Typical floribundas feature stiff shrubs, smaller and bushier than the average hybrid tea, but less dense and sprawling than the average polyantha. The flowers are often smaller than hybrid teas, but are carried in large sprays, giving a better floral effect. So let's bring up Anne Harkness. full, bring it out full screen, and you can take a look at Ann Harkness. This is a Floribunda. And developed by Harkness and Company in 1979. It's an apricot rose with shadings of yellow at the base and in the center, and is notable for flowering very late in the year, producing clusters of 6 to 20 flowers up to 7 centimeters in size. That's 3 to 4 inches, so a little bigger than the polyanthus, but smaller than hybrid teas. With as many as 20 blooms per single massive truss, this rose makes a whole vase full out of one stem. Exceptionally long-lasting in water. The color of its 3-inch double blossoms is amber, shading to gold at the edges. It is a strong, narrow, upright bush with rich, deep green leaves, good repeat bloom qualities. It has stood the test of time, makes a good cut flower. So that's a Floribunda. The other really popular Floribunda, of course, is Iceberg, a pure white rose from German breeder Reimer Cordis, which stole the show in 1958 and is one of the best known of all roses. And there you can see the Floribunda rose flower itself. But if we look at the next picture, you can see what Floribunda really, what this Floribunda really does. Iceberg, it is covered in white blooms and really, really showy, and just makes a real statement out in the landscape and very popular. You can see these all over the place. And come back to me real quick, and I'll show you some Iceberg I cut out of my front yard this morning. Let me get them out. They're not cooperating. Ah, get back. Back, you beast. And now here it is. This is Iceberg, and of course, it may, you know, some of the flowers are a little old, and so the petals are falling apart. This is Iceberg. It is just really, really prolific. Just hundreds of blooms on a single bush, really. And it comes as a shrub form or as a climbing rose. And so if white is the color you're looking for in your garden, you can't go with a better shrub to get white flowers and lots of flowers from spring all the way into the fall. So really nice. Now, once it got hot, the flowers really got trashed. So if you see these icebergs around town right now, that heat we had last night was pretty hard on them. So that's Iceberg. And our next picture, now, as roses tend to do, they throw sports. So there's a burgundy Iceberg, and let's take a look at that picture. This was a sport off Iceberg, and you can get, so bring this up full screen, and this is Iceberg, but it's got this burgundy color. And then the next Floribunda we have is called Fire and Ice. Let's take a look at that picture. This is a picture I took during the week. This is a really nice, this picture doesn't do it justice. It's got white on the backs of the petals and red on the front. Elegant red blend color, repeating bloom throughout the season, good foliage, bloom and light fragrance too. Petal count is around 40. Clusters of flower with pure white centers and flaming bright red edges, rather like the old favorite Double Delight. Fire and Ice should be widely grown for its immense disease resistance. So this is a very good rose for disease resistance. The foliage is lush and glossy, dark green, and makes a wonderful foil for the magnificent procession of strong stems of blooms all over the shrub. The flowers are very durable in the vase, with one stem creating an impressive floral art decoration. Little fragrance. So I got petals everywhere here. So let's talk a little bit about the Grandifloras. That's our next group. Grandifloras were the class of roses created in the mid-20th century to designate back crosses between hybrid trees and Floribundas that fit neither category. So specifically, Queen Elizabeth, and let's take a look. Our next 51 is Queen Elizabeth, and there it is. Introduced in 1954, Grandiflora shrubs are typically larger than either hybrid teas or Floribundas, and feature hybrid tea-style flowers borne in small clusters of 3 to 5, similar to Floribunda. Grandiflora has maintained some popularity from the 1950s to the 1980s, but today they are much less popular than either the hybrid teas or the Floribundas. And here's another, our next, so bring that up full screen so we can get a good look at Queen Elizabeth. And our next one is Cherry Parfait, which is a Grandiflora. And let's take a look at the next picture, which is also Cherry Parfait. So really, this is a white with a red tinge. This, I don't know, I just really find that a fascinating look at that, a fascinating flower with the red edges and the white petals. And so the description I have on this is, picture a thick helping of cherry pie filling on vanilla ice cream as you see, and you see how this bicolor beauty earned its name. Successful in all climates, boasting beautiful large flowers and clusters on well-behaved mounding plant with dark, healthy, disease-resistant foliage. Use the nearly continuous blooms of this yummy rose to pair with perennials or shrubs or display the outstanding colors in a striking mass planting. Flowers are 4 inches, fragrance is light, excellent in all climates, outstanding rose for almost any garden. Now the miniature roses are really mutations of regular roses. Dwarf mutations of some old garden roses, Gallicas and Centifolias, were known in Europe in the 17th century. Although these were once flowering just as their larger forms were, miniature forms of repeat flowering China roses were also grown and bred in China and are depicted in 18th century Chinese art. Modern miniature roses are largely derived from such miniature China roses, especially the cultivar Ruletti, a chance discovery found in a pot in Switzerland. Let's take a look at our next, just a picture of a basic a miniature rose. This is 54. This is called Meleandrin. I bring that up and you can see, so, you know, now they have very small flowers. So miniature roses are fun. Not really a landscape plant so much because they're just not going to put on a show. A rose, Meleandrina, is the typical miniature. The blooms never quite open all the way and remain nice, timeless, semi-open buds till they wither. One nice thing about them is that they stay beautiful for a rather long time. So that's this rose Meleandrina. Climbing and rambling roses. Let's talk about those for a minute. All of the roses we've talked about, both old and modern, have climbing forms, whereby the thick canes of the shrubs grow much longer and more flexible than normal than the bush forms. In the old garden roses, this is often simply the natural growth habit. In many modern roses, however, climbing roses are the results of spontaneous mutations. For example, climbing peace is designated as a climbing hybrid tea, for it's genetically identical to the normal shrub form of the peace hybrid tea rose, except for its canes are long and flexible, i.e. climbing. Most climbing roses grow anywhere from 8 feet to 20 feet in height and exhibit repeat bloom. Rambler roses, although technically a separate class, are often lumped together with climbing roses. They also exhibit long, flexible canes, but are usually distinguished from true climbers in two ways. A large overall size, so is a once-blooming habitat. Climbing and rambling roses are not true vines, such as ivy and clematis, because they lack the ability to cling to support, so they need support. Climbing roses don't have tendrils that grab on anything, so you have to tie them up to something. And let's take a look at number 55. This is Zephanin Drohin, and this is a climbing rose. But like I said, you can get climbing roses in almost all the standard roses have a climbing counterpart. This is actually a bourbon rose. Although the flowers individually are not all that spectacular, as a climbing rose, they give off this spectacular effect in the landscape. The semi-double blooms are a pure shade of bright rose pink, an almost thornless variety. Zephyrin Drohin is the name. Prefers warmer climates. Controlling disease can be a problem on this. Vigorous to 12 feet tall. There is also the shrub form of roses, and our next one is Rosa Mulinae, and that is a bright yellow shrub form. This is not a precisely defined class of garden rose, but it is a description of or grouping commonly used by rose reference books and catalogs. It encompasses some old single and repeat flowering cultivars as well, and modern roses that don't fit neatly into other characteristics. This is an excellent rose for bedding, although it is equally good for the border. It flowers with exceptional freedom and continuity, and it even has upright growth and little to no disease. Now, the other group that we can talk about, not officially recognized group, are what we call the English or David Austin roses. And development of the David Austin roses started in the 1960s by David Austin in England, who wanted to rekindle interest in old garden roses by hybridizing them with modern hybrid teas and floribundas. The idea was to create a new group of roses that featured blooms with old-fashioned shapes and fragrances that would evoke the classic images of Gallica, Alba, and Damask roses, but with modern repeat blooming and the modern color ranges as well. He mostly succeeded in this mission. His tribe of English roses, now numbering hundreds of varieties, has been warmly embraced by the gardening public and are widely available to consumers. They are still actively developing roses, with new varieties released regularly. Typical winter hardiness and disease resistance of the classic old garden roses has largely been lost during this breeding. So you need to take a close look and see if you want to grow a rose. And I would not grow roses that are highly susceptible to powdery mildew and rust, because that's just going to be a real problem for you trying to really do them well. Let's take a look at number 57. This is Abraham Darby, introduced in 1985. This is a David Austin rose, bred by crossing the climber Aloha with the Floribunda Yellow Cushion, and is named after the industrialist Abraham Darby. Deeply cupped flowers have an average diameter of 5 inches. Color varies according to the climate and ranges from soft apricot pink on the inside, pale yellow on the outside in warmer areas, to rich peachy pink with lighter edges in cool climates. Grow in small clusters and are usually very I'm not sure what that word is. As they tend to bow their heads, Abraham Darby is suited to be trained as a climber. The next one is Tamora. This is another Austin rose, number 58. Take a look at that. One of the earliest varieties and still a worthwhile rose. It is closely related to the old Gloire de Dijon, and it has inherited both its lovely glistening apricot color and its delicious fragrance. Short bush, suitable either for rose bed or border. The flowers are at first attractively rounded, opening to a shallow cup. Has a remarkable and unusual fragrance, similar to lilac. So now there are also some roses that were breeded for Canada, and they are referred to as Canadian roses. The two main lines of roses were developed for the extreme weather conditions of Canadian winters by the Agriculture Department in Canada. They are called the Explorer Series and the Parkland Series. These programs have now been discontinued. The remaining plant stock has been taken over by private breeders and marketed along with the Canadian artist roses as a single series. So now there are other roses that are called landscape or ground cover roses, and they often only get about 2 feet high, and they cascade. They just keep going, doing this, and they cover, and they use it for a ground cover. Let's take a look at 59. This is called Rosy Princess. This is a ground cover rose. Bring that up full screen. And you can use this not as a shrub, but as a ground cover. And let's take a look at 60, and you'll see kind of the effect of it. You could have this instead of growing a lawn, and it would be a lot prettier, and you wouldn't have to mow it. Let's take a look at number 60, which is Rosy Princess. And you can see kind of the effect of it en masse. Those are the flowers, really pretty flower, single, in a kind of an apricot peach. And let's see if we have 60. I guess we don't have it, or it's slow to come up. Well, there it is. Bring that to full screen, and you can get an effect. So if you had this as a ground cover rose, you'd have that kind of carpet. They're called carpet roses or ground cover roses, and they only get about 12 inches to 24 inches in height, and the canes come up and then lay down on the ground again, and you get this carpet effect. And they're a little higher than some of the other ground covers, but you could mix and match with some other ground covers, and they give you a lot of color. Now we have another video clip, very similar to the last one we saw, really almost identical, except it covers the hybrid roses. So let's go to our third video clip on hybrid roses, and this is very similar to the last one. So if you're interested in some different rose varieties to grow, get a pencil and paper and you can jot it down. If not, you'll find this video clip on YouTube. Let's go to this video clip. Thank you. Nice clip. Just show you a couple roses here, then we're going to talk about diseases real quick. This is a hybrid tea. This is called Brandy, and this is one of my favorite roses. I've got a couple in my front yard, so that's Brandy. I don't get much of a problem with it. It's on the west-facing side of my house. Gets lots of sun, real hot out there. And believe me, the heat can take a beat up your roses in midsummer. But anyway, so nice rose. The buds are a deeper apricot color, and it lightens up as it opens. And then this one here is another rose. I don't grow a whole lot of roses, but this is called Betty Boop. This is a Floribunda. And just covered with blooms. A great landscape plant because it puts, you know, the color is just spectacular. Let me move it a little over here. So this is Betty Boop, a Floribunda that's really, really colorful and just grows like crazy. Now, we had some questions about watering. I've only been watering my roses every 2 weeks, starting in March. So we had March and April, and I've only been watering every 2 weeks. I probably only watered once in March, actually. You don't need to water these things constantly. It's not a lawn. They are deeper rooted, and they don't need that much water. They're not really thirsty plants. They're not high water use plants like a lawn or some of the other materials like a fuchsia or ferns. I mean, those are going to use a lot of water. Roses are going to use significantly less water. You probably have to water them once a week in the heat of the summer, that's for sure. It's not like cactus that you can water once a month and then let them go dry all summer if you want. So it's not, you know, a dry landscape plant or a xeriscape, but they usually can have a spot or two for a rose in your yard and not really waste water. And I've seen people say, water your roses every other day. That's just ridiculous. Why would you water something every other day if it's not a lawn? Now, pruning. Generally, you know, what we need to do with our roses in the winter, now it depends on the different kinds of roses you're growing, but if you're growing a modern roses in the winter, in California, we have to prune them down really low, usually to about 12 to 24 inches, you know, it's about shin to knee height. Prune back to like 4 canes, remove all the foliage, and prune to an outside node, especially that's how you prune the hybrid teas, probably the grandifloras and the floribundas too, really, for that matter. But you don't have to do that. You can prune them to 3 feet if you want. You can let them get as big as you want. They get bigger and bigger if you don't prune them back. But they don't bloom really strongly in the spring unless you force them into dormancy. One of the main reasons we prune is to force roses into dormancy. Now let's take a look at a few diseases before we move on. Let's go to our next picture, which is powdery mildew. And that's number 61. Bring it up full screen. Powdery mildew is real common. Some plants are going to have good resistance, others not so much. You're going to get this mostly in the spring, especially when we have overcast weather in Southern California, June gloom. You can control this with milk and water, or you can control it with potassium bicarbonate from the new potassium bicarbonate, maybe neem oil, but only in the spring when it's not over 90 degrees. But this tends to kind of go away a little bit as we get warm in the summer. Now our next picture, let's go to our next picture, is a rose mosaic virus. This doesn't hurt the roses particularly. It's not a really devastating infection, and there's nothing you can do about it. There are no treatments, and so if you see it, you just know what it is. In a lot of plants, these mosaic viruses cause color break in the flower. I don't know that they do that in roses. I haven't heard that. But just to show you what rose mosaic virus looks like, it is only graft transmissible. It will not move on your pruning shears from plant to plant. So you don't have to worry about having a plant with rose mosaic virus in your landscape and then having it get to the other roses. It won't do that. It's not mechanically transmissible. It's only graft transmissible. So if you've got a plant that's infected and you propagate from that plant, then you'll have infected a new plant. If you take a cutting from a plant that's not infected and graft it onto an infected rootstock, it will go through the graft union and infect the new rootstock or the scion, the cutting that you grafted on. Now our next picture is black spot. Let's go to that picture and bring that up full screen. A black spot, I never even saw it until I started working at the Huntington, and I was told when I took some classes at Cal Poly Pomona that we didn't get black spot in California, but we do. But it's not very common, and only certain cultivars get it really bad. Here are the typical black spots. They're kind of fuzzy around the edge, not a real hard line. And so the best thing to do is to grow plants that don't get it or are highly resistant to it. And if you see this develop on your plants, you need to remove the infected foliage as soon as you see it. And then during the winter, remove, you know, when you're pruning back to, you know, four canes or three canes that are about shin high to knee high, get rid of all the foliage, rake up all the leaves from underneath the plant, get them out of there, that'll go a long way to helping to prevent black spot, or, you know, because the spores are going to come from the old leaves you left that, you know, accumulated under the plant the previous season. The other thing that would be really beneficial is after you clean up all those leaves and get rid of all the foliage when you do your winter pruning, is to put down a thick layer of mulch, maybe, you know, 3 to 4 inches thick. And then if there's any spores that might be in the soil when it rains during the winter, it won't splash up onto the plant. Remove any old canes that have cankers or disease as well. It may not be black spot, it's not black spot. But you do want to remove the old canes that are the oldest canes and save some of the new green canes, the younger canes. Let's look at our next picture, which is rust. And bring that up full screen. This is rose rust. Again, you're going to do the same thing that you do for black spot. As soon as you see the rust starting up, then you're going to want to remove the leaves and put them in the trash, get rid of them. It probably wouldn't survive in a mulch pile anyway. You could throw it in the mulch pile. And let's come back to me and I'll show you some leaves I picked earlier. You can spot the rust really easily. Let's go to the overhead real quick. We only have a couple minutes left. We can go to the overhead and take a look at this. You'll see that the leaves get yellow and they get spots all over them on the top. And if you flip it over, you see the orange pustules underneath. So here, these are rusted leaves. And if I flip it over, you can see that there are these little orange pustules, you know, and this will get worse over time. And these spores get splashed off onto their foliage and start new infections. So pull off any infected foliage. And if it really gets bad, then you'd have to use a broad-spectrum fungicide. Then the next really common problem is our next picture, which is aphids, which you see in the spring. Bring this picture up full screen. And this is typically what you see on a new bud. If you don't control this, it'll ruin the flower. So you can either spray this off with a strong stream of water or hit it with soapy water or hit it with an oil product or, you know, you could use Volk oil, sunspray, ultrafine oil, neem oil, canola oil, mint oil. There's all these oil products out there now. We're down to our last 30 seconds. This is our last broadcast of this semester. We'll be back in the fall. If you want to contact me, let's see if we can bring up my email address. My full-time position is the plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office. Let's see if we can bring that up. My email address for the LA County is jturney@acwm.lacounty.gov. But if you just contact the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, they can direct you to my laboratory. If you have a plant problem and want to send me a sample or ask me questions about how to maintain your landscape, please contact me. I'll see you next semester. I'm not sure what day we start, probably in September. Until then, I want to wish everyone happy gardening. Thank the crew for all their hard work putting on the show over these last months. Enjoy the summer, enjoy your gardens, and we'll see you next fall.